الرحمن علم القرآن خلق الإنسان علمه البيان الشمس والقمر بحسبان والنجم والشجر يسجدان.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. السلام عليكم my friends, welcome back to another episode of the Revelation Audio Experience. I'm Meraj Mohiuddin and today we're going to be diving into some of the earliest Meccan surahs. So far we've covered the prologue and we've covered the first three Quran years, talking about context, talking about history, talking about seerah, the context in which the earliest Meccan surahs were revealed. Today what we're going to do is we're going to pause the story and dive into some of these revelations. Remember, we're building for mastery here, so we're going to be building on each surah, understanding each surah, and then moving on into the stories deeper. So what we're going to be doing in this series is doing a general overview of the seerah and also a general overview of the Quran. Very important that you understand that. I am not going to be able to hit every single detail or every single verse mentioned in every single surah. And this is neither a tafsir. This is going to be an overview, like I said, a flyover of the Quran as we're doing a flyover of the seerah at the same time. So that's what we're planning to do today. And we're going to be beginning with Surah Al-Alaq, which is the 96th surah in the compiled order of the Quran. So as you know, Surah Al-Alaq is the first surah revealed to the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, in the cave of Hira. It is 19 verses, and only the first 5 verses were revealed at that first instance of revelation. The remaining verses, verses 6 through 19, were revealed to the Prophet Muhammad sometime later. After those first 5 verses, then he got revelation or parts of revelation from Surah Al-Qalam, Surah Al-Muzammil, Surah Al-Mudathir, and Fatiha, and so forth. So the first few verses you've heard before. It starts with, "Read in the name of your Lord who created human beings from a clinging thing. Read, for your Lord is most generous. He taught with a pen. He taught human beings what they didn't know before."
اقرأ باسم ربك الذي خلق خلق الإنسان من علق اقرأ وربك الأكرم الذي علم بالقلم علم الإنسان ما لم يعلم.
So off the bat, what we're seeing here is this incredible emphasis on reading, writing, reciting, education. And this is something that is very important to our tradition. We can't ignore this, right? The opening word is read or recite, iqra. And what's interesting is that even if you look in secular circles, anthropologists, they define human beings as, animals, I guess you would say, who have the unique capacity of language. Okay, so this is even from a secular perspective, not a religious perspective. One of the things that makes us unique from all other creation is our capacity to speak, read, write, convey information across generations. Most animal species, whatever they know, it comes through instinct or it comes through experiential knowledge. We're different than all of the animals in that we are able to pass down information. I can, the stuff that I am telling you right now is not stuff that I have experienced or instinctually know. It's stuff that has been written by scholars and has been passed down to me. Animals can't do that. This is uniquely a human trait. And we even see in the story of Adam alayhi salam, Allah says that he taught Adam the names. We're talking about learning. We're talking about language acquisition and the capacity to learn and grow. So this is a very unique human feature, and Allah is calling this out in the very first revelation. No doubt. Not surprising at all. He told Adam that he will send guidance down from time to time. And here, when the guidance comes down to the Prophet Muhammad, peace upon him, again, we're talking about knowing the names of things, knowing how the world works and being able to pass that down through language. So Allah is saying that he taught human beings what they didn't know before. And that's certainly the case. This is more than mere instinct or experiential knowledge. And yet Allah continues in this, human beings are still so rebellious. We consider ourselves to be independent, yet back to your Lord is the return.
إلى ربك الرجعى.
What I love about this surah is that it is called Alaq, which means the clot, the clinging thing. We know from biology that an embryo, when it forms, it attaches to the lining of the uterus. It is clinging. It literally is a clinging clot. You couldn't, and they could not have known this at the time, the Arabs. But Allah is saying that He created human beings from a clinging thing. And perhaps that is referring to this clinging clot, right? In previous generations, in the tafsir, it says that this was referred to as a blood clot. However, you know, looking at embryology and so forth, some scholars suggest this is talking about the embryo itself is clinging. Now, the reason why I'm talking about this right now, aside from the fact, the scientific fact that it is interesting, is because psychologically, if we go back to that conversation that we had about attachment psychology and how we are constantly clinging to something, remember I told you about that book, Hold On To Your Kids, and it describes how children at the end of the day are constantly have a desire, an instinct to be attached to someone. Right? They have a desire to be attached, usually to their parents. It's an instinct that cannot be abolished, but it can be subverted. So if a child is not getting the attachment it needs from the parent, then it will attach onto something else like other peers. And it is a very difficult thing for parents to break that attachment to peers and bring that attachment back to themselves. This is a deeper conversation on child development and so forth. But the takeaway from me is that all human beings, not just children, we have this desire deep down that we cannot abolish. It is an instinct that we cannot break. And that is to be attached to something. And that attachment gives us a feeling of safety and security. It gives us a feeling of belonging. And these are deep, deep human instincts. You could call this our fitra state. Our fitra, our natural disposition, is to be connected to something that is secure and is not vanishing. And we see this play out when we looked at that story of Ibrahim al-Islam, who was looking for an attachment, right? His father disowned him. Remember, that was an attachment, and his father said, I will stone you. So he cut that attachment. Ibrahim al-Islam is looking for attachment, and he goes and he says, oh, perhaps the moon is my Lord and the sun is my Lord. That is the greatest. But he says, my heart isn't set on things that disappear. Meaning his heart, the thing that his natural disposition, the instinct to attach, he wants to attach to whatever is greatest and is eternal. And this to me is a metaphor. It's a parable of man who is looking for the ultimate attachment. Here we see Allah saying that humans were created from a clinging thing. They have attachments. And yet despite this, when they get older, they act like they don't have this instinct. And so they act self-sufficient. That's what Allah says. We're so utterly rebellious. And even though back to our Lord is the return. So this is really important, I think, to me. I get so much out of this surah because it reminds me and it reminds all of us that as independent as we think we are, we have our salaries, we have our spouses, we have all of the social constructs that make us comfortable. Yet in the end, we forget that it's really only Allah who is the one that we can rely on, who we are attached to. And so this is what we are seeing in this opening verse. It is reestablishing the nature of the relationship between Allah and mankind. And remember, this deen is about managing that relationship. Now we're going to move on to the last parts of this surah. Now the background of these verses we get from hadith from Imam Ahmad and Tirmidhi and so forth. And what we understand is that when the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, started praying at the Kaaba, people were surprised at what he was doing. They were confused. And one person in particular, who was probably the nastiest of all to the Prophet Muhammad, the one of them from the Quraysh, the leader, by the name of Abu Jahl. Abu Jahl was from the very powerful clan of Makhzum. And when he sees the Prophet Muhammad doing this, he swears by the gods Al-Lat and Al-Uzza. He says, if I ever catch him in an act of worship, I will set my foot on his neck and rub his face in the dust. This is Abu Jahl. This is the way he was. A very nasty, nasty person. And so he wants to make good on this threat that he makes. And so when he sees the next opportunity where the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is praying, he steps forward to put his foot on the Prophet's neck. But suddenly he becomes frightened and he runs away. When he's asked about it later, he said that he had seen a vision of a ditch filled with fire and this kind of fiery winged beast threatening him. Now, when the Prophet Muhammad heard about what Abu Jahl had said, he remarked, "If he would have come near me, the angels would have struck him down and torn him to pieces." So it is said that this passage coming up is revealed about Abu Jahl and those others like him who forbid people from praying to Allah. So the passage goes on, "Have you ever seen the one who discourages a servant from praying to God? Do you think he's being guided or even concerned about God? Or does he deny the truth and turn aside? Doesn't he know that God is watching him?"
أرأيت الذي ينهى عبدا إذا صلى أرأيت إن كان على الهدى أو أمر بالتقوى أرأيت إن كذب وتولى ألم يعلم بأن الله يرى.
Now in another instance, when Abu Jahl later saw the Prophet Muhammad praying again near the Kaaba, he came up to him angrily and said, "Didn't I tell you not to do this?" The Prophet, peace be upon him, scolded him back and said that he had a right to pray there. And when Abu Jahl said, "How dare you scold me?" the Prophet said, "By God, with one call I can fill this valley with supporters." Then the remaining sections of this verse were revealed. It says, "Let him be warned then, that unless he changes his ways, we'll drag him down by the hair of his forehead, his lying, sinful forehead. Then let him call upon his supporters for help, for we too will call upon the forces of torment. Absolutely not. Do not let yourself get sidetracked by someone like that. Rather, bow in adoration and draw closer to God."
كلا لئن لم ينته لنسفعا بالناصية ناصية كاذبة خاطئة فليدع ناديه سندع الزبانية كلا لا تطعه واسجد واقترب.
This surah is instructing the Prophet Muhammad, peace upon him, to read. It's telling him that what makes us special is our capacity for language. That is what is going to elevate us. That is what also elevated Adam, right? Because he was taught the names. He was a learning creature, and we too are learning, and we have responsibility to continue learning our entire lives. We have a very intellectual tradition, and Allah gave us intellectual faculties as a gift, and we have to use them. Allah is also telling us that we have a basic attachment. We are attached. We were born attached. We were a clinging thing. And yet when we get older, we become so arrogant and rebellious against the same one who we are returning to. The surah goes on to talk about what was going on in Mecca, specifically with Abu Jahl and his friends, that they used to torment the Prophet and block them. But Allah is sending stern warnings to these people like Abu Jahl that they better back off or they will find themselves dragged into the fire. So, how does it end? It ends by Allah again coaching the Prophet Muhammad so gently when he says, "Don't let yourself get sidetracked by someone like that." Basically saying, don't worry about these people. Don't give them the time of day because you're doing something more important. But for now, bow down in adoration and draw closer to God. This word waqtarib is such an important word. Right? Waqtarib, it comes from the same word, the root as qareeb, meaning to be close to. Again, the relationship, my friends. And this is something that I didn't truly quite understand in the beginning. Because when you start with Islamic education, you know, you start with aqeedah, I believe in this and this and this and this and heaven and hell. So you start with all of these what's, and this is what you have to believe, and this is what you have to say, and this is what you do to perform the salah. But what we're seeing here is that the very first surah, it ends with relationship building, draw closer to Allah. This is a statement, one of the few statements in the Quran where we actually make sujood when we hear this verse, because we're putting our head on the ground. We are being intimate with Allah, and we have to draw closer to Him. This is not the only surah where this word comes up. Waqtarib, like qareeb, to come qareeb, right? We have that word in many languages. Qareeb means a closeness. That is the state we can be in where we no longer experience fear, nor do we experience grief. It is that place of qareebness, closeness to Allah. So we're going to end our conversation on the first revealed surah of the Quran, Surah Al-Alaq. And in the next episode, we're going to move on to the next surah, Surah Al-Qalam. In the meantime, I hope you enjoyed this. Please make sure you listen to Hassan Halal's entire recitation, his entirety, on his YouTube channel. Make sure you grab a copy of the Quran, a translation of the Quran, so that you can make your way through it. I myself use multiple different translations of the Quran, and they're all very good. I love Sahih International. I also use Ahmad Zaki Hamad's translation. The one I am using the most, and the one that I really just enjoy because of its ease and accessibility, is the translation by Yahya Emmerich. I think I've talked about this in previous episodes. So if you're reading alongside with me, that might be the easiest one to read alongside with me, because I'm going through his footnotes as well. He has done an incredible amount of research single-handedly to put together a very powerful translation with scholarly footnotes from the original sources. So anyway, I will see you guys in the next episode. Can't wait to see you soon. Take care. Assalamu alaikum.
الذين قالوا ربنا الله ثم استقاموا فلا خوف عليهم ولا هم يحزنون أولئك أصحاب الجنة خالدين فيها جزاء بما كانوا يعملون.